Views and opinions expressed on the following program are those of the hosts and guests and not necessarily those of the staff or management of KLAV.
Welcome to Aspects of Writing with your host, James Kelly. For the next 60 minutes, we'll explore every aspect of writing, including how to create, format, and even sell your work. The phone lines are open at 731-1230. That's 731-1230, or toll free 1-866-820-KLAV. Now, let's get writing. Here's your host, James Kelly.
Welcome to Aspects of Writing. This is your host, James Kelly, here on KLAV. In the studio, we have author, singer, songwriter Nancy Abercrombie, and via telephone, we have singer, songwriter Bobby Joe Valentine and author, singer, songwriter Sandy Kastel. This show is being brought to you by Author.com. The creator of Eric Bowman is a successful author in his own right. He created Author.com, that's AUTHR.com, for those individuals choosing to self-publish or for authors hoping to revive an out-of-print novel. Unlike most funding websites, Author.com offers continues funding after it's you complete your funding. To learn more about this exciting new tool on how to fund your book project, go to Author.com or to Aspects of Writing website and scroll down to the bottom of the page and click on Author.com. The topic of this show is writing music. We will explore the techniques and what it takes to get published as a songwriter. If you are just now tuning in, my guests will be Nancy Abercrombie, Bobby Joe Valentine, and Sandy Kastel. First and foremost, I have one of my guests from our last show on the phone to update us on his new journey, 50 states in 50 weeks. Kevin, are you there?
I'm here, James.
How are you doing, Kevin?
Great. We're having a wonderful time.
All right. So where are you?
We're in Cortez, Colorado. We spent all last week in Utah, went to Salt Lake City and Moab mostly, and spent a lot of time riding on the bike, you know, so wow. Enjoying the beautiful countryside. Man, Utah is a gorgeous state.
All right. Well, you had a great send-off on Sunday.
Oh, yeah. Wasn't that fun?
That was.
A great party, yeah. Everybody had a good time. So,
where are you off to next?
We're going to head up through Colorado to the west side of the Rockies and then cross over into Denver. So,
well, for the listeners who don't know, you were on our show last week and you are an author. And after your 50 weeks of being on the road, I think it's your intent to create a journal about this trip?
Right. Yeah, I'd like to do 50 states in 50 weeks, a journey, book about it.
Yeah.
And then another aspect of writing that I do actually is blogging every day.
Okay.
So we keep a journal every day and people can get on that site and see what we're doing, what's going on.
Well, hopefully you'll tune in next show and let us know where you are the next time.
Okay.
All right. Thanks, Kevin.
Thank you, James.
You're welcome. I'd like to start the show with a few quotes, and I'm going to ask my guests to help out. Sandy, would you like to take number one?
Nancy?
I'm sorry.
Oh, you caught me off guard.
Sandy, are you there?
Yes, I'm here. How are you?
All right. This is Sandy Kastel. She's calling in from Indiana. Sandy, would you like to take number one?
I'm looking for it.
Okay. Well, we'll let Nancy take that one. I'll have you do
it. Yes,
another.
Go ahead.
Okay.
Okay. Robin Gibb of the Bee Gees stated, "I'm really happy that I got to work with such fresh talent in a day when record companies are not particularly good at encouraging young, talented songwriters to come forward and get exposure. I think it's important to give tomorrow's songwriters the opportunity."
And Bobby, are you there? Is Bobby? He's not there. Okay. Well, I'll take number two. Barry Mann is quoted as having said, if it is possible as songwriters, you should also develop yourself as a record producers. And Nancy, how do you feel about that?
Absolutely.
Yeah?
Yeah. To be able to record and produce your own things is essential.
How do you feel about that, Sandy?
I think it's very important, too. I think we have our own ideas about how we want to sing our songs, and when we can work even with the producers or to help produce the songs, it really adds a lot to the outcome of it.
Okay. Now, Nancy, would you like to go ahead and read number three?
Shakira said in an interview, writing in English was a major challenge. I didn't want other songwriters to write for me. I wanted to preserve the spirit of my songs in Spanish. I am the same Shakira in English as I am in Spanish.
Wow, that's pretty
great.
That's
wonderful.
Yeah, absolutely. And number four is songwriters with the most number of one hits. And it was surprising. Paul McCartney. Now, these are songwriters. You know, obviously he's a singer as well, but he actually wrote 32 number one hits. John Lennon wrote 26. Mariah Carey has written 17 number one hits. Barry Gibb, 16. And Brian Holland and Sean Garrett have tied for fifth place with 15 each. And incidentally, the Beatles have sold over 1 billion albums worldwide, followed by Michael Jackson with 750 million.
I had no idea Mariah Carey was that prolific a songwriter.
Yeah, absolutely.
Wow.
All right, if you are just tuning in, you're listening to Aspects of Writing with me, your host, James Kelly, right here on KLAV, 1230 on the AM dial in Las Vegas. And we broadcast live on the internet, www.klav1230am.com. Before we get into the topic of the show, writing music, I'd like to introduce my guests and let them tell you a little bit about themselves. I think you will find they are each accomplished songwriters in their own right. After I introduce each guest, we will listen to one of their songs before I ask them a few questions. We'll start with Nancy Abercrombie. This is her inspirational song about people in the world that make a difference. Here is One of the Chosen Few.
We are blessed this day to have among us someone who is honest and true, a shining example for all of mankind, one of the chosen few. There is no greater honor for a human being than one of the chosen few. Be one of the chosen few. You must use all the gifts you receive. And when people lose hope all around you, by your actions they'll learn to believe. You are one of the chosen few. When you do more than what is required, there is no way to
So, Nancy, why don't you tell us a little bit about yourself?
About myself?
Yeah.
Okay. I came here in 1980 as a singer. I came out of Nashville.
Okay.
And had come here visiting on vacation and saw all the work here. It was wonderful. There were so many piano bars that needed me.
Oh, there was a lot of lounges back then.
And I was working within 3 days of moving here and worked steady for 12 years. And one by one, the places disappeared, the lounges disappeared, and I went overseas. Anyway, I worked as other names besides Abercrombie because that was just too long for the marquee. So I was Collier and I was Hogarth. That was a husband's name that wouldn't let me work unless I worked with his name on my name. And then I became an author and a metaphysical minister and a bunch of stuff.
And also, you had a contract in Nashville at one time, I understand. You?
Oh, yes. I started there. I went there in, I forget what the year was, but I moved to Nashville with a contract from Four Star Music. At that time, it was the number four publisher in the world. And I thought, wow, I've made the big time. Little did I know I was just starting. And I had three other publishing companies I was signed with while I lived there.
What inspired you to write One of the Chosen Few?
Oh. The title just came to me and sat in the back of my head for a while, and I started thinking about, what does that mean? That means someone who goes the extra mile for other people in the world, who has something special to offer. And then when I made the video and that that came about. It was just a wonderful tribute to people who make a difference.
So you had the title first.
Oh, sure. Yeah.
Is that how you, the way
yeah.
you often write?
Yeah. I think 99% of the time the title comes first, and it's just a one-liner, and it goes in the bucket or the drawer with all your other one-liners until it has time to germinate and come about, like you know, in your writing,
mm-hmm,
when
exactly.
it has time to grow and come forward as a whole thing. And then it's just automatic. It just whoosh. It just down on paper when it's ready.
I think that's what's a little bit different about writing songs as opposed to writing novels, because novels, you usually write the novel first and then try and figure out what the title's going to be. So that's interesting. What is the most difficult part of being a songwriter?
Ooh. There's two parts to that. The first part for me is because I'm an inspirational songwriter. I write songs that make people feel good. That's my logo, songs to make you feel good. But it's not necessarily religious. It's not country. It's not pop or one of those categories. It's inspirational, positive message music. So there's never been a category for me. In the various record companies and whatnot, that's been difficult. And the main thing, though, now, because I've finally gotten used to it, I'm not in a category, and people love it anyway. They like the stuff I write.
Yeah.
But to be able to reach the artists that are still out there doing it, people like Cher, who have this incredible voice, this amazing thing that touches my heart like Elvis used to, I have a whole album's worth of music for her, and I'm told she's not recording anymore. And I think that's really a shame, because I want more Cher. I want more of that that soulful thing that she is that just touches me so much. She and Elvis are the two. And the song, one of the songs I have for her is about Elvis, and she does him in her show. And I go, whoa, that'd be a no-brainer for her to do that. But getting to her has been a major thing, and I'm told she doesn't want to record, so go figure.
Where can listeners learn more about your work?
Oh, I have AbercrombieMusic.com
okay.
on the internet, and on my website there's about 100 different songs that they're little clips, like a minute clips of different songs in categories where people can go and hear them. And I do concerts from time to time, and I'll do benefits. And
the next song we're going to do, Nancy, is your song, Hats Off to the Ladies. Can you explain a little bit about that song before we play it?
Sure. Golly, I feel honored. These other people are not getting their stuff heard yet.
Oh, they will.
Okay. This song was originally something I had in mind. I think I heard, Hats Off to the Ladies, probably in a movie somewhere. And I thought, that sounds like something I need to write to honor my mother and the special women in my life who have made a difference. And then a short time later, I got a call from the Women of Achievement in Las Vegas that needed something for their program, and I said, I think I have something for you. And so the song, wrote itself just no time.
Mm-hmm.
And they used it for their achievement awards, and that was wonderful. And that's before Jan Jones got to be mayor and some other gals came to prominence here. Anyway, then I made it into, I'm making it into a video now to be out for Mother's Day.
Oh, that's great.
And Dina Titus has used it in several of her campaigns to hopefully get her to the Senate. And so, whether it be political or just honoring women in general, and also, there's a verse in there about, I had to do this. The song was screaming for something else. And what it was asking me for was to honor the soldiers that have given their lives and are giving their lives so that we can honor our women and our people in this country and feel proud of who we are.
All right, we're going to play Hats Off to the Ladies.
Oh, great.
Satisfied a dream and opened up the doorway to finding self-esteem through their dedication, searching for the truth. They've changed the course of history for me and all of you. To those who've kept a vision, their day has finally come.
We're going to play a song here in a moment by Sandy Kastel, but before we play this song, we have a caller online, I believe a Miss McFadden.
Hello, James.
Hi, Judy. How are you?
I'm doing fine. How are you?
Great.
I'm calling in. Nancy's a friend of mine.
Okay.
And one of the things I want to say is that you don't get the full effect of Nancy until you see her, because there's just a light that comes from her when she's singing.
I agree.
It just reaches out and touches everybody. So, and she's also had she has a CD out. Nancy, I think it's Save the Playground.
Oh yeah, hi Judy.
Hi, and I that's just really nice, because there's something in there that there's a song. You know, it's directed toward our children, saving our children. And so I just wanted to call and say that.
Well, thank you.
What a nice surprise. Thank you.
Okay, I'll hang up. Bye-bye.
Thank you, Judy. And our next song is by Sandy Kastel, and it is the title song from her latest album, Indiana Rain. And here is Indiana Rain.
She woke from a dream and started to cry. She turned to the window and watched the cars passing by. A chill ran through her veins. She remembered he is not here. She buried her head in his pillow and fought off her tears. Indiana rain coming down. It was a cold and icy day when he said goodbye. In her mind, she could see his face and feel him by her side. Her heart is breaking, 'cause he's been gone a year. She's holding on to his memory, but it's time to face her fears. Indiana rain. Says it's time to let you go, but in my heart you'll remain. I promise you we'll be together someday. She took one last look, she turned and she walked away. Indiana rain.
So, Sandy Kastel, are you there?
Yes, I am.
Sandy,
hi,
you're
James.
Hi, how are you?
Good, how you doing?
Great.
And hi, Nancy.
Hi, Sandy.
How are you?
Great.
So,
good.
Sandy, why don't you tell us a little bit about yourself and your accomplishments?
Okay, well, I've always been a performer, James. I grew up here in Las Vegas. My dad's a jazz saxophonist, and when he joined the Harry James Band, he brought us here. We were living in Mesquite, Texas, and he brought us to Las Vegas, and we haven't left. I've been singing here professionally since I was in high school. I toured the U.S. and Canada, and then when I returned to Las Vegas, I did summer rep at UNLV. And then I got into, I was Miss Nevada, and I was the first non-classical talent award winner in the Miss America pageant, which at the time was a pretty big deal because yeah. mostly they had classical singers. And then after that, I was in Jerry Jackson's Pinups at the Movies at the Sahara Hotel, which was the longest running show at the time
okay.
in Las Vegas. And then since then, I've just been working in different areas. A lot of the hotels in Las Vegas. I went to Los Angeles. I've traveled around the country, as I said. And then in 2007, I started recording my original songs in Nashville.
Okay.
That's how I got there. And I released my first album, which, funny as it may sound, I recorded it in Nashville, but it's a tribute to, it's called This Time Around, and it's a tribute to the to Las Vegas and the great performers and songs that they made famous, partly because I grew up in Vegas and I had such a history with it because of my dad and growing up here and performing here in different shows. That's what the producer suggested we do. And then after that, I was able to record my next album, which was is The Indiana Rain, which you heard the song from there, and that
yes.
was my first single. And if you go to my, when people go to my website, they can see the video there and also on YouTube.
So where can people find more information about your songs?
On my website, which is sandycastel.com.
Okay.
Or at WEMAInternational.com, which is an organization that I just recently formed last year. In fact, Nancy is one of our members.
Yes.
And yes. and when we had our first songwriter showcase in January, she was in that, and she did an excellent job, and it was so much fun. We had a great time. But WEMA is Women in Music and Arts. And we are an organization dedicated to empowering artists of all ages through education and mentorship. And, James, we have women in the performing, visual, and performing arts. And we also have monthly mixers, and we do music series, art shows, and conferences. And we raise money for scholarships, and we do community outreach programs. So I'm really excited about it.
And you have another project coming up. You're going to be on this station, I believe May 16th
yes.
is your first show?
Yes, May 16th I will be on KLAV Wednesdays at noon.
Okay.
And I'm going to have, as my guest, I'm going to have a lot of the WEMA members and local artists, entertainers, and authors, and also students of the arts, because we want to bring the students on that are, you know, that are going to be recipients or potential recipients of scholarships later on in the year. And you know, so that should be very interesting.
Okay. Well, Sadie, we're going to play another one of your songs right now. We're going to play Pieces of Dreams, and that song was originally recorded in 1970 for the movie of the same title, and it was written by Michael LeGrand and a husband and wife team, Alan and Marilyn Bergman.
Michelle.
Oh, I'm sorry. Was it
Michelle LeGrand, yeah.
Oh, I'm sorry. Michelle LeGrand. I said Michael. I'm sorry. It's Michelle LeGrand.
That's okay.
And thank you for correcting me. And here's Pieces of Dreams.
Thank you.
Wandering, wandering. little boy falls in search of little boy truth. Will you be ever done traveling, always unraveling you?
The honorific smash debut album, Yay, is gonna make you wanna sing.
Just gotta sing to make the whole world ring. Just gotta sing to take your mind off the hurry.
With hits like Just Gotta Say.
Just gotta sing.
Only in my dream.
It was only in my dream.
Suspicion. It must have been love.
It must have been love. But it's over now. It's all that I wanted. Now I'm living without. Must have been love. But it's over.
Yay is available for a special low price. Visit thehonorifics.com. thehonorifics.com. Yay! Welcome back to Aspects of Writing. Here again, your host, James Kelly.
Well, my next guest was supposed to be Bobby Joe Valentine. We had him at the top of the hour and he dropped off, but I don't know if there's a phone connection problem on his end or what, but we're going to go ahead and play his song, Fly. And Fly was one song of the year from the West Coast Writers Association in August of 2011. I guess you could say Bobby's more of a folk singer. And so we're going to go ahead and play Fly. Well, I guess we're not going to play Fly.
Oh, dear.
We're having problems with the audio. Well, I'm going to tell you a little bit about Bobby. He's from California, and like I said, he was supposed to be on air tonight. He's more or less, I would guess you could say, an inspirational singer. You can learn more about Bobby by going to YouTube and look up Fly by Bobby Joe Valentine. You're listening to Aspects of Writing, and I'm your host, James Kelly, here on KLAB 1230 AM. And in the studio, I have Nancy Abercrombie, and on the phone, I have Sandy Kastel. We're now going to do a roundtable discussion. I'm going to ask a few questions, and then each of my guests will have a chance to answer. So, Nancy, let's start with you. What inspired you to begin your career as a singer-songwriter?
Oh, I don't know that it's something you actually just decide to do one day. I believe that most of us start to write out of pain because we have this angst. Sandy, are you laughing? Yes?
Yes.
Okay, we have this angst, and we want to do a Taylor Swift on everybody and write out our pain and our anger and shame on you, you done me wrong. And so so we write 50 of these things, and hopefully nobody listens to them, and because the object of music should not be to shame anybody into liking you or to get even with your ex-husband, or but you write it out of pain to get it the heck out of your head.
How would you, what's your take on that, Sandy?
Well, I agree. I think a lot of my songs have been out of situations with my husband or somebody that I've been in a relationship with. And what happens is kind of going along and all of a sudden these thoughts just come to your head. Like there's this one song I wrote called Don't Tell Me I Can't. Don't tell me I can, don't tell me I won't. Don't tell me I never will, because you'll be sorry when I'm gone. You can imagine where that came from.
So that starts the situation. And then I studied with Tom T. Hall, and what I learned from him was you take that first 100 songs and you throw them in the trash and hone your skills as a songwriter so that you use proper tools, like learning your language, like Shakira talked about Spanish and English. It takes a bit of doing. You have to tell a story in 3 minutes. And so you have to know what your story is. And for goodness sake, if you want to be a songwriter, arm yourself with a good thesaurus, Roger's thesaurus, so that you can learn different ways to express a certain thought, and a good rhyming dictionary. Too many songwriters like rhyme every other word, or every line rhymes with every other line. Well, this is something that you can do in kindergarten. But there are songs out there that's all they do. The writers go, first line rhymes with second line, third line rhymes with fourth line, and then they wind up really saying nothing. So explore what your topic is, and I'm trying to say, don't write a song unless you have something to say that you can actually make a complete thought that winds up with a beginning and a middle and an end, and it doesn't hurt anybody too bad if you can do that, have it say something different in a different way. Or if it's a love song, say it in a different way that hasn't been done before.
Sandy,
how
do you feel about
There's
that, Sandy?
Too many good ones out there already, you know.
Well, I agree with a lot of what she's saying. Everything what she's saying. The thing about writing a song is it's different than writing a poem. You know, a poem is something that somebody sits down, they write, they read that. With a song, you're listening to it on the radio, you have to grab somebody right away with your idea. So what's important is a great idea, a great title that expresses that idea, lyrics that are easy to remember and easy to sing along with, and that great hook, that either it's a musical hook or it's a phrase, you know. And also what she was talking about with the dictionaries, also, they have books that have phrases, things that we say that are colloquialisms. Anyway, there are patterns to songwriting. Okay, just like what she said, what Nancy said. When you're writing a song, you don't want to ramble on and ramble on and ramble on. What you want to do is you want to make every single word in that song count. And usually you'll have if you have AABA or AB, you know, you have these patterns. So you have your verse first, chorus, verse, say for instance. Mm-hmm. So within that verse, your verse wants to, right off the bat, you want to grab them in that verse. So you really want to make sure that you choose your words. You give people pictures so that they can visualize what is going on out there, and they can get it quickly.
Well, you know, we had lunch one. Nancy and I had lunch one afternoon, and she was telling me about how, unlike a novel, which can be 500, 600 pages, you really tell a story in 3 minutes.
Yeah, yeah.
And that's really difficult to do. That's very incredible.
Yeah, it is challenging, and I was going to say, Harlan Howard, what does he say? What does he say, Nancy? Three chords and the truth?
Yeah, three chords and the truth. Yeah, that's pretty good. Yeah, and
that's
take
right.
Take whatever that line is that you think has too many words in it and cut out the ands and the e's and the these and the shorten it up as short as possible so that it's, and then if it's the right lyric, in my case, the music is sitting right on top of that lyric. The minute that lyric is right, the music is just like floating on top of it. It's amazing for me because I never have to think about the music. Does that work for you, Sandy?
And sometimes, James, you know, when you write the song, you write it, you go away from it for a while, you come back, you edit it, you go away from it a while, you come back, you edit it again and again. And you might edit it five times, seven mm-hmm. times, it may be several times that you edit a song because you're tightening it up each time, making it, like she said, making it, you know, making every word count. And, you know, it said that you know, there's a lot of good songs out there, but there's, you want it to be a great song. And the better that you can make that phrase speak and give you that visual picture, that's what makes a great song.
And
you know?
We're going to play a song right now that's a great example of what you're talking about. And the song is Glass. It's sung by Thompson Square. And
right.
It's a powerful song, and it was written by Ross Copperman and John Knight. So here is Glass.
Okay.
With a heart that can't be broken is like trying to see the light with eyes that can't be opened. Yeah, we both carry baggage we picked up on our way. So if you love me, do it gently, and I will do the same. We may shine. Fragile.
That was Glass by Thompson Square. You're listening to Aspects of Writing with me, your host, James Kelly. And on the show this evening, I have Nancy Abercrombie in the studio, and I have Sandy Kastel on the phone. Our topic for this evening is writing music, and if you've been listening, I think it's quite obvious my guests are quite accomplished in that field. Nancy, in your opinion, what does it take to write a song? I mean, I know you explained what...
I think I already talked about some of that. I think you have to have a reason to write a song. You've got to have something to say that hasn't been said exactly the way that it's been done before. And you have to have feeling, for me anyway. There's no such thing for me as a song, a good song, unless it has an emotion attached to it. Otherwise, you might as well be a bricklayer.
Well, you're an author as well, so you... It's obviously completely different than writing a book.
Yeah, but you have to have a passion about your book or you'll never put it to pen.
Exactly.
You have to have a reason for doing it and something to say that you think somebody else will benefit from and somebody else will enjoy. With music, the music is such an incredible tool. It's the most powerful tool I know to reach the human heart. Mm-hmm. And we should be nice to it. We should write music that embraces and supports the human heart, that gives people the freedom to love like they wrote about in Glass.
Yeah.
That gives you warmth in your heart when you hear it. Mm-hmm. That's what music should be used for. And those of us who can write songs that help people to go there, to appreciate the human spirit and the value of us all, for me, is the most enriching thing in the world to be able to do. To touch somebody's heart with a song and a melody and a word that makes their day.
How about you, Sandy? How do you feel about this?
Well, I agree, Nancy, with what you're saying. You have to be passionate about what you're doing. And everybody writes differently. We all have a different well or a different pool that we pull out of. And some of us, the emotions that we write about are struggles that we go through. Others, like you said, are inspirational songs. Some are independent songs. Some are anger songs. Some are heartbreak songs. So, yeah, I think there's a lot of different stories out there that have been told and expressed. And what we're doing is we are expressing for everyone those emotions and those feelings that are universal. And those are the kinds of songs that will live on and will connect with people. It's the kind of song that when you're sitting at home and you hear it on the radio, you go, how did they know that I was doing? Oh my God, they know what I'm going through. Oh my gosh, how did they write that? And you that. We grow up with songs that we've heard since we were kids. And we can, you know, when we hear that song as an adult, it takes us right back to that very moment. It takes us right back to the exact sense that we were feeling, the smells, the taste, the feelings that we were having, okay, because it touched something in us at that moment in time, and it takes us right back there. What's so powerful about a song.
I'm going to ask both of you a question, too, about maintaining your rights to a song. How important is that?
Oh, very important. It's really getting more challenging all the time. You know, as you know, the industry has changed a lot with everything that's online. And songwriters that are putting their music out there are being... we're seeing this copy that comes across that says, will you agree that, you know, your song can be played here and there if you put it on this site or whatever. And it's very challenging because people just kind of think that, oh, well, we should have the rights to play your song wherever we want to. So it's become that we are struggling to keep the rights, but it is important to copyright your songs. I know you have this question here.
Yes.
And it's very easy to do. I'm just going to let anybody out there know. You can go online and you can copyright a collection of songs. Say you have 100 songs that you've written, or 100 poems, or 100 whatever.
Right.
you can write them, you can copyright them as a collection of songs, and then as you progress and you go along and you start shopping your song, and if one of your songs is going to get cut, then you copyright it individually also. After, you know, but you can keep it in this collection, so it's very reasonable. What is it, $35, Nancy?
I think it's 40 now, and you can list 40. As a compilation. You can list all the titles that are in there, so that at least your titles are protected within that. Category, absolutely copyright before you do anything, don't put it on YouTube before you copyright it.
That's right, and you send your lyrics in, and you can also, there's different ways you can send just the lyrics, or you can send it in with the CD of the songs demoed.
You can send MP3s right to the copyright
now, that's right, because you can do it online now, so they make it very, very simple for us to do, and it's so vitally important. Also, I'm going to throw something else in here for young songwriters out there, or whatever age you are. If you are writing a song, co-writing a song with another person, before you start to write that song, have an agreement between the two of you that states, we are co-writing the song, it's 50-50, or it's 70-30, or whatever it is. Typically, in Nashville, if there's five people in the room when a song is being written, it's split five ways. Mm-hmm. Now, typically also, though, a publisher, just keep this in mind, a publisher is not as crazy about taking a song that has five authors on it, okay, five songwriters. They don't want really any more than two, and at the max, three. You know, so try when you're co-writing to just write with one other person, all right? And get your agreement up front so that you both know, so there's no surprises. And also, if there's any publishing involved or anything like that, make sure that that's clear up front.
Yeah. Well, I'm gonna go to the next topic, which is we're going to talk about Dolly Parton for a minute. With she wrote the song I Will Always Love You, and obviously that song was recorded several times. A few things people don't know about that song is that it was actually a number one hit three times, and no songwriter in history has ever done that.
Isn't she amazing?
It's amazing. And I need to go ahead and give you the last minutes of the show, and then we're going to play I Will Always Love You. On the next show, the topic is going to be promoting your work, and we will discuss the many ways you can promote your work without spending a great deal of money by utilizing the radio, book signing events, and lectures. My guest will be an author. It's Patrick Powers and Dana Michelli of writersinthesky.com. I'd like to thank my guests, Nancy Abercrombie and Sandy Kastel, and hopefully Bobby's listening out there. if you can find links to all their projects and information about my guests at Aspects of Writing on the website www.aspectsofwriting.com. That's www.aspectsofwriting.com. Aspects of Writing broadcast live every other Monday at 9 o'clock p.m. Pacific Standard Time here on KLAV and on the internet at www.klav1230am.com. And we broadcast every Wednesday on VegasAllNetRadio.com at 8 o'clock p.m. Pacific Standard Time. Future air dates and lineups can also be found at aspectsofwriting.com. The last song of the evening appears at number 68 on Billboard's Greatest Songs of All Times. The single spent 14 weeks at the top of the U.S. Billboard Hot 100, and at that time, it was the only song that ever was on 14 weeks. I think there's a couple songs that have surpassed since. Thank you for listening to Aspects of Writing right here on KLAV. This is your host, James Kelly, reminding you, if you can dream it, you can write it. And now Whitney Houston's version of I Will Always Love You.
Thank you, James.
Should stay. I would only be in your way, so I'll go, but I know I'll think of you every step of the way. And I will always love you.
bittersweet memories. That is all I'm taking with me. So goodbye. Please don't cry. We both know I'm not what you need. Darling,